Hey guys, I'm stylist Polly Kul, and this is a series of fashion videos where we talk about the history and DNA of brands in Kering Holding. And today's video is dedicated to Yves Saint Laurent brand. So let's get started. If you are a big fan of this brand, as I am. So once again, I'm going to remind you that the purpose of this series is to analyze the DNA and the philosophy of each brand and to make you a more conscious consumer. So when you are about to buy an expensive purse, you will know which brand to choose because you will understand its philosophy. So let's talk about the history of Saint Laurent brand. So I'm not going to deepen into the details of Saint Laurent's life, but of course I'm going to mention the most crucial facts which had a great influence on his life and on his vision of his fashion brand. So let's start. And please don't mind me looking at my phone. I just wrote down a plan, all the important facts and dates we are here to discuss, because actually it's impossible to remember all of them and I don't want to make any mistakes. So Yves was born in 1936 in a wealthy aristocratic family in Algeria, which was a French colony. After graduating from school, he moved to Paris, where he participated in a competition which was about creating some designs made from wool. And at first he didn't achieve any success, but then he participated in this competition again. He won his prize for the best woolen evening dress. And that's how his career started. His sketches were published in French Vogue and he was noticed by Dior House. At first, he started to work there on design of accessorizes, and then he was given the opportunity to create couture collection in Dior. And after Dior's death, Yves became the new creative director of this brand. And talking about his further collections, well, they were quite beyond the Dior's philosophy, because Dior was a conservative brand for rich women from aristocratic families who wanted, you know, like classical, beautiful Dior's evening dresses. But Yves wanted to recreate the brand's philosophy and to bring a fresh perspective. And actually, people who were behind Dior's brand didn't enjoy it that much, and so did the customers. Talking about their specific collections if made for Dior. So the first collection he made by himself for this brand was in 1958, and it was called Trapezoids. And it was a collection for young girls. So, as I already mentioned, he wanted to bring a very fresh perspective. In 1960, he created a collection called Beatnik. It included short motorcycle jackets and suits with turtlenecks. But then Yves got a conscription, and talking about his life, his year in French army, that was a really tough time for him. After spending 20 days in an army, he was sent to hospital with a nervous breakdown. And talking about the Dior brand, well, actually, it used this conscription as an excuse to get rid of Yves Saint Laurent, because his designs were too extreme for such a conservative brand. No offense to Yves Saint Laurent or Dior. But after coming back from the French army, Saint Laurent and his business partner Berger, they filed a lawsuit against Dior. And with the money they won, Yves opened his first boutique. and he called his brand Yves Saint Laurent. In 1962, Yves Saint Laurent created his first ever collection for his own brand. And this collection was a total revolution because Yves Saint Laurent brought men's youth to women's fashion. And also this collection included Mandarin dresses, balaclavas, and naked shorts. The next collection he created was called Russian Ballet. And no doubt that Yves thought that his consumers were the new generation because his designs were a total fresh perspective on fashion. And not every conservative Parisian would like his designs. By the way, that's quite funny because nowadays Yves Saint Laurent is considered to be, well, not exactly a conservative brand, but some of his designs are considered to be classical and timeless. But despite all the success, it's important to mention that Yves suffered from depression and from drug addiction, and that's why in 1993 he had to sell his house to a pharmaceutical company. This company was called Sanofi. So Saint Laurent started to do only high fashion, and his first collection of couture, it was a collection with a molded breast and belly, and creative director Albaz created ready-to-wear collections for Yves Saint Laurent brand for 3 seasons, and he created this a cult image of black jacket and tights, which is known as the classy, the most Saint Laurent look of this brand. The next creative director was Tom Ford, and he brought some artism to the brand, and that's why now we can associate some extremely sexy things with Saint Laurent. In 1999, the brand was bought by Kering Holding, and of course that was the time when the new history for Saint Laurent brand started. In 2004, Stefano Pilati came to the brand as a new creative director. In 2012, the next creative director was Eddie Sliman, and it's important to discuss his details. Again, I didn't deepen into the history and biography of previous creative directors in Saint Laurent brand, because as I already mentioned, at the end of this video, the most important thing, my purpose, is to sum this all up and discuss the DNA of the brand. What are the most iconic purses of this brand, its prints, its designs, and etc. And in the end of this video, we're going to discuss the latest 2024 collection, and we'll see which DNA details are included there. So the next creative director is Eddie Sliman. He got rid of this famous ISL logo because he thought that if was no longer alive, it would be strange to have his name and to, you know, have this association with the past, Saint Laurent, and he wanted to bring something new to the brand. And also he moved the headquarters to California, and that was quite a strange action, let me say, but anyway, he's famous for creating the image of the Saint Laurent girl who is a total rock star. He brought grunge style into the brand, thinness, monochrome with metal, and of course that led to big sales, to big popularity of the brand, as this grunge aesthetic was on top at those times. In 2016, after Sliman, the next creative director of Saint Laurent was Vicucci Rella. and he brought sexuality and latex and asymmetry and of course mini length to Saint Laurent brand. Nowadays, the creative director of the brand is Anthony Vaccarella, and closer to the end of this video we are going to discuss his latest collection. But now let's sum all the information up and discuss the DNA of this brand. So the DNA of Saint Laurent is of course Le Smoking, which was created in 1966. This is Elegance, which was brought from Dior brand. We remember, yeah, that he worked there. Transparency, chiffon on naked body, naked blouses, erotism, giant shoulder saddle, print piece, bows, print kisses, feathers, and of course black, white and pink colors, and some retro motorcycle aesthetic. So talking about the latest collection, we can see motorcycle suits like in Bad Pink Dior collection in 1960, motorcycle gloves and helmet and handkerchief. We can see naked blouses, elegant dresses, dress with futuristic neckline like in Trapezoid's collection in 1958. So I hope that you guys enjoyed this video and learned new information about Yves Saint Laurent brand. If you have any questions left, I'll be more than happy to answer them, and I'll see you in the next episode of fashion series about Kering's brands. See you!